Yeah, I'll see you all in hell, too. Remember that. Every one of you, I'll see you in hell.
Caius Veovis, take a seat at Hampton Superior Court, where Caius Veovis, a high-ranking member of the Hell's Angels outlaw motorcycle gang, was about to be sentenced. Veovis, along with other members of the Hell's Angels, had brutally murdered three Pittsfield men in August 2011. Brace yourself as we delve into the chilling details surrounding this crime, and most importantly, find out what the judge's verdict will be. Caius Veovis, born Roy Gutfinski Jr., emerged from the shadows of the criminal underworld in the late 1990s. With a reputation for ruthlessness and a penchant for violence, he quickly rose through the ranks of the local gang scene, becoming a feared and respected figure. Veovis's troubled upbringing, surrounded by violence and crime, set the stage for his descent into darkness. As a young man, he found solace in the camaraderie of gang life, where he honed his skills and embraced a life of crime. But it wasn't long before Veovis's criminal activities took a sinister turn. He became involved in a series of shocking crimes that would leave the community reeling. In August 2011, Veovis, along with two other men identified as Adam Lee Hall and David Chalew, kidnapped three Pittsfield men, David Glasser, Edward Frampton, and Robert Chadwell, and brutally murdered. According to reports, one of the men, David Glasser, was to testify against Adam Lee Hall, who was also a high-ranking member of the Hell's Angels. To stop him, he was brutally murdered, while the other two, who were his roommates, were also murdered to eliminate any witnesses to Glasser's murder. All three victims were last seen in Glasser and Frampton's apartment on August 28, 2011. Almost 2 weeks later, their dismembered bodies were discovered buried in a trench in Beckett. The impact of Veovis's participation in these murders extended far beyond the immediate victims. Families were torn apart, forever scarred by the loss of their loved ones. The community rallied together, seeking justice and demanding an end to the reign of terror. The pursuit of this dangerous criminal became a top priority, with investigators leaving no stone unturned in their quest to bring him to justice. Finally, after a lengthy and intense investigation, Veovis was apprehended. The trial that followed was a spectacle, with the media covering every twist and turn of the proceedings. The courtroom was filled with tension as the prosecution presented their case, painting a vivid picture of Veovis's crimes and the devastation they caused. The defense, faced with overwhelming evidence, tried to paint a different picture of Veovis. They argued that he was a product of his environment, a victim of circumstance. They attempted to humanize him, to make the jury see him as more than a cold-blooded criminal with a weird appearance. However, the jury, faced with the weight of the evidence, had no choice but to find Veovis guilty on multiple counts of murder and other charges.
You upon your oath say the defendant is guilty of murder in the first degree. So say you, Mr. Foreperson. Was this the verdict of the jury?
And then came the moment of truth. The judge, with a stern expression, delivered the sentence, three consecutive life terms. It was clear that Veovis had no intention of ever changing his ways or seeking redemption. His reaction to the sentencing only solidified his reputation as a cold-blooded criminal, unrepentant and beyond redemption.
My hand was not in this. And I will not let this man sell me my own hide at the price of my integrity. But I'd rather spend the rest of my life in prison and be able to face myself in the mirror at the end of the day and make that kind of deal.
The impact of Veovis's crimes on the community cannot be overstated. The scars left by his reign of terror will forever serve as a reminder of the darkness that can lurk within the human soul. George Gould Thomas. At the Western Cape High Court, sentencing is currently underway for the man called Violence. George Gould Thomas rose to infamy as the ruthless leader of one of the country's most notorious gangs. But his reign of terror would come to a crashing halt when justice finally caught up with him. Take a seat in the courtroom as we delve into the crimes committed by George Gould Thomas, the harrowing details of his trial, and the ultimate sentencing that left a nation in awe. In the sprawling streets of Cape Town, a young boy named George Gould Thomas grew up amidst poverty and violence. From an early age, he was exposed to the harsh realities of life, where survival often meant resorting to crime. But little did anyone know that this young boy would one day become the infamous gang leader known as Violence. George Gould Thomas was born in the 1970s, a time when Cape Town was plagued by social unrest and economic inequality. Growing up in impoverished neighborhoods, he witnessed the desperation and hopelessness that gripped his community. It was in this environment that Thomas's path toward a life of crime began. As a young boy, Thomas found himself drawn to the allure of the local gangs. It wasn't long before Thomas's curiosity turned into action. He joined a local gang known as the 28S Gang, subgroup under the Numbers Gang deemed one of the most dangerous in South Africa. Thomas quickly gained a reputation for his fearlessness and willingness to do whatever it took to protect his turf. As Thomas's influence within the gang grew, so did his circle of loyal followers. With his gang by his side, Thomas began to establish control over his neighborhood. Businesses were forced to pay protection money, and those who dared dared to defy him faced brutal consequences. Violence became his trademark, earning him the chilling moniker, Violence. News headlines were filled with stories of Thomas's reign of terror. His gang was responsible for numerous acts of violence, including murders, assaults, kidnappings, and also drug trafficking. As George Gould Thomas's criminal empire continued to grow, so did the list of heinous crimes attributed to him and his gang. From the darkest corners of Cape Town to the surrounding areas, their reign of terror left a trail of devastation in its wake. Law enforcement agencies launched a massive operation to dismantle Thomas's criminal empire. Undercover agents infiltrated his gang, gathering evidence and building a case that would bring him to justice. It was a dangerous and painstaking process, but they were determined to put an end to the violence.
The case has been described as the biggest and most complex gang prosecution in the province. During the trial, six state witnesses were murdered, allegedly on Thomas's instructions while he was incarcerated.
Finally, the day of reckoning arrived. George Gould Thomas stood trial for his crimes, facing a litany of charges that included murder, assault, and racketeering. The courtroom was filled with tension as the prosecution presented a mountain of evidence against him. After weeks of intense courtroom proceedings, the jury retired to deliberate. Finally, the moment arrived. The jury returned with their verdict, guilty of 57 out of over 150 charges. With the guilty verdict delivered, the courtroom braced itself for the sentencing of George Gould Thomas. He was eventually sentenced to 7 life terms in prison, ensuring that he would never walk the streets as a free man again. Surprisingly, Thomas had a huge grin on his face as soon as he heard the judge's verdict. Lee Rios. Let's head to the Hampton Superior Court, where 25-year-old Lee Rios is about to be sentenced for the murder of 18-year-old Kenneth Lopez. Rios, who was a reputed member of the violent Latin Kings gang, was said to have lured his victim out and then brutally murdered him with the help of his gang associates. Brace yourself as we delve into the details of this case, the trial, and sentencing of this vicious gangster. In the gritty streets of Springfield, Massachusetts, a young man named Lee Rios would rise to infamy as one of the most feared and ruthless gang leaders in the city's history. Born into a world plagued by violence and poverty, Rios found solace and a sense of belonging within the ranks of the notorious Latin Kings gang. But little did anyone know the extent of the darkness that lay within him. As a teenager, Rios began his descent into a life of crime, starting with petty thefts and minor offenses. But it wasn't long before he caught the attention of the Latin Kings, a notorious gang known for its ruthless tactics and iron grip on the city's underworld. The Latin Kings saw potential in Rios, recognizing his street smarts and his willingness to do whatever it took to rise through the ranks. Under their guidance, Rios quickly climbed the ladder, earning the respect and fear of those around him. He became a force to be reckoned with, a leader among his peers. With his charisma and natural leadership abilities, Rios soon established himself as the head of a powerful faction within the Latin Kings. As Rios's power grew, so did the violence and chaos that plagued the streets of Springfield. Gang wars erupted, leaving a trail of bloodshed and destruction in their wake. Law enforcement agencies struggled to contain the escalating violence, but Rios seemed untouchable. One of the most chilling crimes attributed to Rios was the murder of 18-year-old Kenneth Lopez. The events that unfolded on that fateful night in March 2015 would forever haunt the memories of those who witnessed the brutality of Rios's actions. Prosecutors would later reveal that Rios meticulously planned the killing, driven by a deep-seated vendetta against Lopez. The two had once been acquaintances, but a falling out had turned their relationship into a powder keg of resentment and animosity. On that fatal night, Rios, with the help of his gang associates, lured Lopez from the safety of his home under false pretenses. It was a trap, carefully orchestrated to ensure that Lopez would meet his untimely demise at the hands of Rios himself. In a desolate alleyway, Rios confronted Lopez and shot him multiple times, each shot sealing Lopez's fate. Instead of remorse, Rios reveled in his actions, boasting to his fellow gang members about the killing, as if it were a trophy to be displayed. However, little did Rios know that his actions had not gone unnoticed. The authorities swiftly launched an investigation, determined to bring him to justice and put an end to his reign of terror. The trial that followed was a spectacle that captivated the nation. The courtroom was filled with tension as the prosecution presented its case, laying bare the shocking details of Rios's crimes. Witnesses took the stand, recounting the events of that fateful night and the role Rios played in Lopez's murder. Rios, however, maintained his innocence, claiming that he was being falsely accused by individuals looking to strike a deal with the prosecution. His defense attorney argued that there was no concrete evidence linking Rios to the crime, and that the case against him was built solely on the testimonies of unreliable witnesses. But the jury saw through the smoke and mirrors, recognizing the weight of the evidence presented. After careful deliberation, they delivered their verdict. Lee Rios was found guilty of first-degree murder. The judge wasted no time in delivering the sentence, life in prison without the possibility of parole.
As to count one, jury having convicted you of murder in the first degree, sir, I'm sentencing you to NCIC Junction for the term of your life without the possibility of parole.
Next, we make a stop at Jefferson County District Court, where Abel Gallegos is about to be sentenced on multiple charges, including murder and second-degree kidnapping. Gallegos, a feared and reputed high-ranking member of the Crenshaw Mafia Bloods gang, was convicted along with his gang associate after the body of his 28-year victim, Simon Duran, was found burning near a dumpster in Golden in November 2018. Take a seat as we uncover the chilling details of this murder and what the punishment would be. In the crime-ridden streets of Colorado, one name struck fear into the hearts of both law-abiding citizens and fellow criminals alike, Abel Gallegos. Born and raised in the tough neighborhoods of Jefferson County, Gallegos was destined for a life of violence and crime. From an early age, he became entangled in the web of a notorious gang known as the Crenshaw Mafia Bloods, a ruthless organization that ruled the streets with an iron fist. The authorities were well aware of Gallegos' criminal activities, but his cunning and ability to evade capture made him a formidable adversary. He seemed untouchable, operating in the shadows, orchestrating crimes with precision and leaving no witnesses behind. But it was his involvement in a high-profile shooting that would ultimately seal his fate. Late evening of November 5th, 2018, chaos erupted on the streets of Golden as gunshots rang out, shattering the peace of the neighborhood. The victim, a young woman named Simone Duran, was caught in the crossfire, her life tragically cut short. Gallegos, along with his associates Alonso Quintana and Rene Rosales, had assaulted the oblivious Duran, who met Gallegos off social media. All three men not only assaulted her, they also imprisoned her in the back seat of a vehicle, then drove her to a dark, secluded spot at 7th and Nile in Golden, where Quintana and Gallegos shot her 10 times. The trio then went ahead to set her body on fire. It was a senseless act of violence that sent shockwaves through the community, leaving friends and family devastated. As the investigation unfolded, the pieces of the puzzle began to fall into place. Simone Duran, a brave soul who had previously identified Gallegos as the shooter in a separate crime, had unwittingly become the target of his wrath. It was a chilling act of retaliation, a warning to anyone who dared to stand against the gang. Finally, after a relentless pursuit, law enforcement agents managed to apprehend Gallegos. And so, Abel Gallegos found himself facing the consequences of his actions. The courtroom became the stage for his trial, where the shocking details of his crimes would be laid bare for all to see. Finally, after weeks of intense deliberation, the jury reached a verdict. The tension in the courtroom was palpable as the foreperson stood and delivered the fateful words, "Guilty." Abel Gallegos, the once feared gang member, now faced a lifetime behind bars. The judge, in a powerful statement, addressed Gallegos directly, condemning his actions and the devastating impact they had on the community.
This was a horrific crime. I am struck by the casualness in which it was committed, the absolute disregard for human life.
He emphasized that the sentence handed down was a reflection of the severity of his crimes and the need to protect society from individuals like him.
This is the result. This is where you will end up, with your family and friends crying as you're let out of the courtroom to serve the rest of your life in prison.
And so, Abel Gallegos was sentenced to life in prison with an additional 163 years, ensuring that he would never again walk the streets as a free man. All through, Gallegos showed no emotions that indicated regret or remorse for his actions. At Hampton Superior Court, Adam Hall, a Berkshire County Hells Angels motorcycle gang leader, is about to be sentenced. Adam Lee Hall was convicted in a triple murder case along with three other members of the club after three men were kidnapped and dismembered following his order. Sit back and brace yourself for a roller coaster of emotions as we uncover the dark secrets and heinous crimes that led to this shocking turn of events and what the court's verdict will be. Adam Lee Hall, a name that would soon strike fear into the hearts of many, was born and raised in the small town of Peru, Massachusetts. Growing up, he was known for his rebellious nature and a penchant for trouble. As a young man, Hall found solace and a sense of belonging within the Hells Angels, a group notorious for their criminal activities and fierce loyalty to their brotherhood. The Hells Angels is a well-known outlaw motorcycle gang. Its name is a testament to its reputation as it sends shivers down the spines of law enforcement agencies and citizens alike. This infamous motorcycle club, founded in California in the 1940s, quickly gained a reputation for its rebellious spirit, criminal energy, Enterprises and its all-too-famous emblem, the Winged Skull. Over the years, the Hells Angels expanded their influence, establishing chapters across the United States and even internationally. It was within this world of danger and intrigue that Adam Lee Hall would rise through the ranks, eventually becoming a top-ranking member of a Western Massachusetts chapter. Hall's ascent to power was not without its fair share of bloodshed and criminal activities. He was well known as a ruthless enforcer who was willing to do whatever it took to protect himself as well as the interest of his chapter. For Hall, the ways of the Hell's Angels became his way of life. He embraced the outlaw lifestyle, reveling in the power and notoriety that came with being a Hell's Angels leader. However, what brought Adam Lee Hall to public attention was his role in a set of murders that rocked the entire nation when the news first got out. It all started on July 21st, 2009, when Adam Lee Hall purportedly lured and beat up David Glasser with a baseball bat after accusing him of stealing a car part. In retaliation, Glasser reported the case to the authorities, and on July 23rd, 2009, the Berkshire County Drug Task Force arrested Hall on drug, gun, and assault charges after interviews with Glasser and a search of Hall's home. On September 30th, 2009, Hall was released from the Berkshire County Jail and House of Correction after paying a $50,000 bond. However, an upcoming trial was set against him following the gun, drug, and assault charges, and Glasser was supposed to be a witness. Between August 27th and 28th of 2011, Glasser, along with two of his friends, Edward Frampton and Robert Chadwell, mysteriously disappeared from Glasser and Frampton's Linden Street apartment in Pittsfield. Weeks later, on September 10th, 2011, police, after an intense investigation, discovered the dismembered bodies of all three men buried in a trench on private property in Beckett. Hall and two other men identified as David Chalui and Caius Viovis were charged with the murders. The news of these gruesome murders sent shockwaves through the community, leaving a trail of fear and uncertainty in its wake. The evidence against Hall and his co-conspirators was overwhelming, painting a vivid picture of their involvement in these heinous acts. The trial that followed was a gripping spectacle as the prosecution meticulously presented their case against Hall. Witnesses testified to the months of torment Glasser endured at the hands of the Hell's Angels president. The motive was clear. Hall wanted Glasser silenced permanently. The prosecution argued that the murders of Frampton and Chadwell were part of a calculated plan to eliminate any potential witnesses. After weeks of gripping testimony and intense deliberation, the jury reached a verdict. Adam Lee Hall was found guilty of three counts of first-degree murder, along with several other charges.
The evidence in the case is not overwhelming, yet it is convincing, clearly convincing, beyond a reasonable doubt.
The sentencing was a moment of reckoning for Hall. The judge delivered a scathing condemnation of his crimes, and due to its sheer brutality, Hall received three consecutive life sentences.
For the term of life, without the possibility of parole.
As his sentence was being read, Hall displayed no emotion at all. The Hell's Angels leader, who had once reveled in his power and influence, would now be spending the rest of his life behind bars. The lengthy prison sentence was a stark reminder that even the most powerful individuals are not above the law. Antonio Davenport. Our final case unfolds at a Durham County courtroom where Antonio Davenport, also known as Lil Tony, was about to be sentenced. The 27-year-old gang leader was to be sentenced following his role in the murder of 9-year-old Zion Person. Take a seat in the courtroom as we explore the rise of Davenport, his involvement with the 8-Tray Gangster Crips, and the tragic events that led to the murder of an innocent child. From an early age, Antonio Davenport found himself enticed by the allure of gang life and the power it promised. It wasn't long before he became a member of the notorious 8-Tray Gangster Crips, a criminal street gang known for their ruthless activities. Davenport, also known by his street name Lil Tony, quickly rose through the ranks of the gang, displaying a natural talent for manipulation and intimidation. With his imposing presence and cunning mind, he commanded respect and instilled fear in those who crossed his path. His involvement with the 8-Tray Gangster Crips gave him a sense of belonging and a platform to exert his dominance. But it wasn't just the allure of power that drew Davenport to the gang. He was also a member of a Durham-based rap music group called 83 Babies, named after the 8-Tray Gangster Crips. Through their music, the group glorified gang life, rapping about the harsh realities of the streets, gun violence, and drug distribution. Davenport's involvement in the rap group further solidified his reputation as a prominent figure within the gang. As Davenport's influence grew, so did the criminal activities of the 8-Tray Gangster Crips. They engaged in a wide range of illegal activities, including drug trafficking, bank fraud, and acts of violence against rival gang members. members, shootings became a regular occurrence as they sought to establish their dominance in the criminal underworld. However, Davenport's reign of terror would soon face a formidable challenge. In August 2019, rival gang members assaulted him on the streets at South Point Mall in Durham. The rival gang members taunted him, further fueling his thirst for revenge. Davenport, never one to back down from a fight, conspired with fellow gang members, including Derek Lamont Dixon, Jr., also known as Smack, to retaliate against their rivals. They were determined to restore their reputation and show the world that they were not to be trifled with. On a fateful evening, Davenport, Dixon, and their accomplices embarked on a mission of vengeance. Armed with deadly weapons, they set out to target an area known to be frequented by rival gang members. They planned to strike fear into the hearts of their enemies and re-establish their dominance. Little did they know that their actions would have devastating consequences. Davenport and his gang members spotted a car that they believed belonged to their intended target. It was a car similar to the one used by the individual with whom Davenport had exchanged threatening Instagram messages. Fueled by rage and a thirst for vengeance, they opened fire on the vehicle, unleashing a hail of bullets. The car carrying innocent passengers was caught in the crossfire. In the chaos and confusion, tragedy struck. 9-year-old Zion Person, who was riding in the car with his aunt and four other children, became an unintended victim of the gang warfare. Two bullets pierced the window next to Zion, striking him in the head and ending his young life in an instant. His 8-year-old cousin, seated next to him, was also injured, struck in the arm by a stray bullet. The scene was one of utter devastation. The senseless violence had claimed the life of an innocent child, forever altering the course of their lives. As the realization of what they had done sank in, Davenport, Dixon, and Magwood fled the scene, leaving behind a trail of destruction and grief. The investigation into the shooting was a race against time. Detectives from the Durham Police Department, in collaboration with the Federal Bureau of Investigation, FBI, and the Durham County Sheriff's Office, worked tirelessly to gather evidence and piece together the events that led to the tragic death of an innocent child. One crucial piece of evidence came from the court-ordered ankle monitor Davenport was wearing. It placed him at the scene of the murder, providing a crucial link between him and the tragic events that unfolded that night. The trial was a harrowing experience for Zion's family, who had to relive the pain of their loss in the courtroom. They sat through the proceedings, their eyes fixed on Davenport, hoping for justice to be served. After a grueling trial, the jury delivered their verdict. Antonio Davenport was found guilty of one count of violent crime, specifically murder, in aid of racketeering. The weight of his actions and the devastating consequences they had on an innocent child's life were undeniable. But the trial was not the end of the story. Davenport's sentencing would determine the punishment he would face for his heinous crimes. The judge, taking into account the severity of the offense and the impact it had on the community, handed down a sentence that would ensure Davenport would never walk free again. Antonio Davenport, the gang leader who had once reveled in his power and dominance, was sentenced to life in prison. The judge's decision sent a clear message that such senseless acts of violence would not be tolerated. Davenport displayed no emotions as he sat in the courtroom listening to his sentence. And that brings us to the end of this shocking video on gang leaders reacting to life sentences. Their stories serve as a chilling reminder of the darkness that can lurk within the human soul, but also of the power of justice, community, and the indomitable human spirit. For more fascinating videos like this, click on the cards showing on your screens and I'll be waiting.